We're not actors or TV personalities. We're just a couple of guys who want to show you how to restore your car. Sometimes we mess up. Sometimes we consult the pros. It's never a problem. It's always a project.
This week on Autorestomod, Vinnie gets the wrong idea about chokes and deals with the PCV, while Jeff talks a lot of hot air and goes all electrical on a 347.
Order a bunch of parts to get ready for the car show this weekend?
And I got a hot deal, too.
You think? Think again.
Oh man.
Tired of back orders? You need NPD. With four strategically located superstores, orders are shipped direct to your door within 1 to 3 business days. National Parts Depot has quality restoration parts for Ford truck, Mustang, Camaro, Chevelle, and Firebird. For your free catalog, visit NPD online or call toll free.
Not that kind of choke. Automotive chokes.
Oh, yeah. Oh, my bad.
Well, you know, sometimes these things happen. But look, man, we got a lot to do. We need to get busy.
Well, let's get to it.
Hey, get up. We got work to do. Well, while Dustin recovers and Vinny gets everything ready for us to take to the O-Team hideout to work on the Fairlane, I'm going to take a couple seconds to go over chokes and why you actually need one. Now, literally every internal combustion engine on the planet uses a choke. It may not have it when you get a hold of it, but I can guarantee you that everything has one on it pretty much. Now, the reason you want a choke is this. Choke is going to make your life easier on startup, and in fact, your EFI engine, or electronic fuel injection engine, is actually choke operated as well. You just can't see it because it's all done within the internals on the EFI. So it's not visible, but the choke is still there. Anytime you start the engine up, your idle will be a little bit higher and you'll see the idle drop down after a couple of seconds. Well, that's the choke on the EFI in operation. Now, we're going to be going over the three different types of chokes that are available. We're going to have a hot air choke, a manual choke, and electric. Now, basically, those are the three that you're going to use on just about any engine, like our little 347 here with its Holley and Wien intake manifold and headers and all the other stuff. So, I'm going to get ready and we're going to head over to the O-Team and see what we can do to get that Fairlane where it'll start up and run cold. Or hot. Okay, we're now over at the O-Team hideout. Basically, that's where the Fairlane's been in position for a little while. So we want to come over here and show you how to set up a hot air choke. Now, one of the first things I wanted to talk about is the fact that we got a set of choke tubes for a 351 Cleveland from the guys at National Parts Depot. Now, these choke tubes are stainless and you can get them from there. One of the things a lot of times you run into on a Cleveland is the fact that this piece right here will be missing because it'll have a cover plate on it. It won't actually be a choke plate like this one. And we found that some of the middle 70s and early 70s small block 302s will actually have one of these plates on it. So you can use one of those off of a 302 if you can find one. If not, you're gonna have to scrounge that plate because they're not being reproduced yet. Could be something that's coming, but for right now, they're not available. Now, basically what you have is underneath this plate, there's a ring setup that goes out to these two tubes. It picks up hot air off of the exhaust manifolds. It bleeds back and forth across this, makes kind of a warming plate, if you will, inside the intake manifold to help heat up things. Because one of the things a lot of guys don't realize is that when you're running a carburetor setup like this, and the fuel is coming in there and it's pulling air in there, it's actually going to make the carburetor somewhat cold. Therefore, I recommend a choke. Now, we're going to be hooking up a hot air choke on this one. We could do an electric choke, but since this car has the full facilities to do a hot air choke, we're putting the hot air choke on it. Now, in doing that, like I said, we've got our tubes hooked up to the base of the choke here, and then we've also got these tubes on the back here hooked up with a rubber hose that connects to the base of the carburetor like this. And basically, that's just a fresh air tube that lets you pull fresh air into the tube assembly and into all of this so it draws correctly. Now, since we've got our choke all torn apart from having rebuilt this 4100 Autolite, we're gonna have to go back in and set up the choke. Now, pretty much everything is the way it needs to be. We're pretty close on all of our adjustments When all of this is set up and shut down, that's almost closed. You want to have that. The toughest thing I found is actually trying to get this spring assembly to line up with this tab here, making sure that the tab is on either side of the spring assembly, because what can happen is, when you put this on, if you're not real careful with it, you can actually just have it on one side of it and you end up thinking you got everything set up just right, and it's not. So basically what I'm going to try to do is to set it on here. That feels like it's on there. And now what I need to do is to put the tabs and screws on here. We've already got one on the bottom. We need to get the rest of these tabs in place before we start doing anything else. Doing this, you're going to want to have the engine completely cold. You don't want the engine hot while you're trying to set the choke, because it pretty much defeats the purpose. We've got about a 50 degree day out here, which is why I'm sitting around with a long sleeve shirt on. So we're pretty sure we're going to have a really cold start on this one. Now also, I'll say this on a Ford setup. What you'll want to do is to have the hose coming off of the water pump on the, there's a piece that sits on here that puts the hose up next to the choke housing, which adds a little bit of heat in and gets the hot air choke operating a little bit quicker. Now I've got these screws all on here and ready to go. So what I want to do is actually rotate this backwards until the choke closes. And that's usually about 90 degrees. You'll notice I put a piece of tape on here, and the tape is actually pulled over to a 90 degree position. Now we've gone 90 degrees rich, if you will. So now I'm going to take this and actually tighten these up a little more to make sure that this thing will stay on here. All right, now what I'm going to do here is, we've got a couple of other 4100s laying around and 2100s, and with a choke in this position, these are typically running about 3/32 opening on the back side of the choke between the plate and the horn. So I've got a 3/32 drill bit that I'm going to put in here, and we're pretty close. We're a little tight on that, but I don't think that's going to be a problem. And I kind of feel like that's an ish, because I've seen these with much bigger drill bits that Ford used in order to set this up with a much greater opening set on the choke. I want this a little tighter because it's a little chilly out. Now when the summertime comes around, we won't need that much choke, so we may go back in and lean this thing out a little bit when summer comes around. But for right now, that's a good start position for our choke. So I guess the only other thing to do at this point is to start it up and see if what we've done actually works. Now I'm going to go in off camera and put the screws back in here, but I shouldn't need to show you that. Okay, now we're in the car. We're going to go ahead and start it. Now what you do with a hot air choke, in case you're not familiar with how these things operate, some of your older guys are going to just kind of phase out for a second, but with a hot air choke, you want to get in the car and put the accelerator all the way to the floor the first time, and that'll jet some fuel in there, and then it'll also close the choke down so that you can get the car to start in theory. Now keep in mind, this is the first time on this car with this choke setup, so we're not sure it's set up exactly right. And we haven't tuned this car the way we did the 65 last week, so I'm not sure what I'm going to get with this. Now you'll notice that the carburetor plate has pulled open a little bit. This thing's got a mild cam in it, so it's a little noisy. But before now, we would have to play with it and play with it to get it to run at all. So this is actually working pretty good. I'm pretty happy with this. We're going to go in and start messing around with the choke a little bit to make sure it runs correctly in a cold idle. Okay, now we've done a dry run with the carburetor with no other adjustments done to it. One of the biggest things you'll find on a hot air choke is the fast idle adjustment may be set too low. Now on an Autolite 4100 and some of the early 2100s with a hot air choke like this style, there's a screw in the very back that you'll want to screw in order to in or out to get your adjustment on it. So on this one, we're going to screw it in a little bit so we can pick up the fast idle on it. And you'll want to make that adjustment with it running. And the thing about that is you need to make the adjustment pretty quick, because it's not going to take long before the carburetor starts coming off of choke. But really, that's basically everything you'll need to do, is make your adjustments for your fast idle, and you're going to want to be about 1200 to 1800 RPM on your idle. All right, now what I'm going to do here is I'm going to go in and set the fast idle on the cam. Now, because Bill doesn't have a tack oil meter, I'm actually having to set this thing up by ear. When we get it back over to our shop, we're gonna go in and tune the car, and we'll go and make sure all this stuff is correct. So basically, you can hear the change in the idle. This car has a pretty good little cam in it. It's not super hot. It's got a crane cam in it, so it's not gonna idle like a stock 351 Cleveland. But we've gotta do some tuning on it. I've shown you how to do that. Now we've gotta go in and take care of it. Now I'm gonna shut this thing down. I'm gonna let Vinnie talk to you a little bit about some of the stuff with the PCV setup.
When you're planning out your carburetor and intake, you need to plan ahead just a little bit. Let me show you why. A lot of the aftermarket carburetors have a flat bottom, and you can just use a flat spacer, and then the port for your EGR PCV is right on the carburetor. Now, in our case, we had an aftermarket intake, and we wanted to use the Autolite 4100 carburetor, and you can't use the flat spacer with the Autolite 4100. Now, the problem we ran into is we also wanted to run the EGR and the PCV. Well, there's no port on the Autolite 4100 for that, so we had to get a Boss 302 spacer from NPD, and that makes everything work perfectly. If we had used the original spacer with the aftermarket intake instead of the Ford intake, we would have run into a big vacuum leak problem right here. We decided to run the PCV EGR system on our car just because it keeps it a little bit cleaner. It's not only environmental, but if you don't run the EGR and the PCV, you'll get exhaust and oil out of the breathers that'll really dirty up your valve covers over time. So this just makes it a little bit easier to keep the engine bay clean when we're going to a car show.
Okay, now we've got everything set up. We've let the thing run till the engine is at op temperature. We're now gonna go in and loosen this choke plate, because right now it's not opened up at all. So what we're gonna do is take this from the position it's in and get our butterflies to open up. Now, that's about right there, so we're gonna set it because that's fully open and we should be good to go on this choke setup. And we're gonna go back to our shop and talk to you a little bit about electric chokes and finish this bad boy up. Well, we're back at the 65.
Indeed. It's actually running pretty good.
Yeah, it is. The only thing I'll say about it is you got a manual choke on there, and I mean, that's, you know, kind of a neither here nor there. But the nice thing is National Parts Depot sent us a choke cable. Basically, you're gonna be able to put this on here to control this rather than having to do like you've been doing.
Oh, so I have a manual choke I can control from inside the car.
Yes, awesome. It'll be awesome. You'll be able to control awesome. From inside there. So there's the choke. I'll get out of your hair so you can talk to them about what it does.
Easy. Now, like Jeff was talking about, this is a manual choke and it is the most basic choke you can have on a car. Basically, we're gonna run this cable and it'll connect here, and we'll run that inside the car so you'll have a knob to pull. And when you pull that, you'll be toggling this butterfly valve and choking the engine for easier starts. Now, the good part about it is you have complete control over the choke, and you pull the choke, start the car on a cold morning, you go on down the road. The bad part is sometimes people forget to turn the choke off and you end up running kind of rich, the car starts running a little funny. Now, the manual choke is the way to go on a high-performance car.
All right, we've talked to you about manual chokes and we've talked to you about using a hot air choke. Now what I'm going to show you is an electric choke. Now the reason you would want to use an electric choke on a car, in my opinion, is if you're running headers like this engine has here. This is a small block 347 that we're going to be putting in a 64 Falcon, so it is a high performance engine and you're going to want to run headers on it. Trying to run a hot air choke on an engine with headers is really problematic. For one thing, there's not a whole lot of good places to actually put the tubes for the hot air choke. Most exhaust manifolds are going to have those provisions, or there'll be one in the intake manifold like the Cleveland we showed you a little bit ago. However, when you've got headers, there's no provision for it. So with the electric choke, basically you have an electrical connection on the actual choke housing here, and it's grounded like you see the ground wire here. You go with this blade to a 12 volt power supply on the car. It has to be keyed though, because otherwise this choke will stay live all the time and you don't want that. An electric choke is basically operating off of an electrical charge. It's not operating off the hot part of the engine. It's operating off of a bimetal inside of the choke itself over here. So what you need to do is realize that it's probably not going to run as long as a hot air choke would run, and that will make it so that the engine will probably still be a little colder than it would be with a hot air choke. I like an electric choke in a high performance application, especially if you're running headers, because a hot air choke, it's really tough to get the air off the headers to be hot enough to do what you need it to do. If you're working with one of these with an electric choke, that's not an issue. You just go ahead and plug it in, get your 12 volt keyed source, and you're good to go.
So that's this week's episode, everything you need to know about chokes, or chokes.
Well, yeah, because I'm pretty sure he hasn't quite actually recovered from that yet.
Oh, yeah, we're worried about him actually.
In any case, folks, whether or not he recovers, that's beside the point. He's a minion and we can replace him. Next week, we're going to be coming back to you with an episode on springs. We're going to be looking at trying to get Mike Eaton from Detroit Eaton Spring down here to work with us on that. So if that happens, we'll do that. If not, we'll be coming to you with an episode on how to work on the horn assembly on your beep car. Yeah, to make sure the beep beep works. Because otherwise, if somebody does something really heinous in front of you in traffic, you won't have any way to do anything but to give him the one-fingered salute. That one, hopefully. In any case, do us a favor and come back and watch us next week on Autorestomod.
I hope I didn't hurt the minion too bad.
It's just a minion. We'll get more.